Welcome back, everyone. It's Monday, and so as usual, it's time to look at our portfolio very briefly. We are at around plus 16% since inception. The largest position is Meta. Now we are at plus 150%, and it covers around 16% of our portfolio. And then, as you can see, if we look at the losers for the moment, we are at an unrealized gain of minus 4% for T. Rowe Price. Actually, this stock is becoming again more and more interesting because we bought it at around $100 and now it's trading at $96. And at least on X Guy and on Twitter, I saw that many dividend stocks investors became happier and happier to see T. Rowe trading below $100 once again, actually, because I think when we bought it at 100 and it briefly went maybe to, you know, 98, 97 and all the way back up to 110, 115. And now once again, we are below 100. So definitely what we can say is that we like for now our position in T. Rowe Price, and we covered it a few months ago at least. And then the other losers of our portfolio are Pfizer, now at around minus 12%, and EL, the Estée Lauder companies, at around minus 20% since we bought it. If we actually switch to Finviz, we can take a look at what has happened last week, and we can see, for example, that among our holdings, we have Microsoft at around minus 0.3, Google minus 1.3, Meta minus 2%, so nothing too big has happened. I mean, of course, if you want, we can go and take a look at Nvidia. It lost around minus 9%, Tesla minus 15%, but these are more usual oscillations for these kind of companies. And then, as we were saying, if we go and look at Pfizer, we are at minus 4.5%. And then the Estée Lauder companies right here, they actually just lost minus 0.3%. So most of the unrealized gain that I showed you before on the Google spreadsheet has actually happened in the previous weeks and not this last week.
Few weeks ago, we showed a screener that was meant to closely follow one of the Warren Buffett filters. We told the story that oftentimes Todd Combs went to Buffett's house on Saturdays and they would talk about stocks and opportunities, and Warren would ask a few questions, three in particular, and we tried to implement those questions in a screener. So take a look at that video for the details. But now we tried to create a screener that is also looking at high quality compounders in the way that we understand them and we covered on this channel very often. The two main factors that generate value in a company and therefore in the stock in the long run are its ROIC and the growth of the company in the sense of revenue growth, for example, if the margins are stable. So in this screener, for example, we have a condition on the ROIC of last year that has to be larger than a threshold. This threshold is now set at 15%, but in general, we will change it and we will comment on what happens. But also we added another filter, another condition on the return on assets, and we want also the return on assets to be relatively high. So in this case, for example, we set the return on assets to be larger than 7%. Again, these are just numbers. We will change it a little bit and we will see what are the results. Then we also have a condition on the payout ratio, because we know that if a company has a high return on invested capital, but also high payout ratio, then it will not compound at that return on invested capital. Then we have a threshold on the EBIT margin. Now, we could also have a threshold on the gross margin, and we perhaps will talk about it next time. And this is a way to just select companies that have to have some competitive advantage, because otherwise their EBIT margin would be quite low. Then going back to the second factor that determines value, so the first one was ROIC larger than a threshold. And this threshold, by the way, has to be related to the weighted average cost of capital. But typically, if we set this threshold high enough, it will for sure be higher than the weighted average cost of capital for that stock. So instead of going into the details of the cost of capital and other factors, we just select a threshold that is higher than, let's say, 12, 13, 14%. And that's okay with us. But the other factor is growth. Here, we select two different filters for this. One is revenue growth and one is cash from operations. And we want to see some growth over the past few years. So in this case, we selected 7 years, and we want to see at least a CAGR of 2% or more. Then finally, we show in the table some other parameters. Here on Ticker, when we select a property, we can either select a threshold for this property or just display. And this will just display that number in the table below. So for example, for the diluted weighted average shares outstanding, we just select display and it will show below. So for example, in this case, we want to show the CAGR, so the growth in the number of shares in the last 10 years. And we want to see a number that is negative in this case. Or if positive, it has to be very small because we don't want to be diluted. Then also we select stocks that performed relatively well in the last 5 and 10 years. So we want to see some performance that is relatively good in the market. And also finally here, we show the ROIC and ROA for several years. So in 2021, 2020, 2019. And this is just to show to the right of the table what is the evolution of ROIC. And this is because we would like to see some consistency in these returns, because sometimes, especially when companies are cyclical, it may be that the ROIC or ROA is very high this year, but this is an anomaly. This is, for those companies that are cyclical, the peak of their profitability. That is not the average profitability that they will have. So, for example, this is very common for commodity-based companies. So when companies sell a commodity, sometimes commodities are very expensive. And so in those years, these companies will make a lot of money and their ROIC is very high. But then typically there's a cycle, commodity prices go down. And in that case, then the ROIC becomes very low. So we want to avoid that. We want to see some sort of consistency. And so we display here a few years. But of course, one could go into even more details and look at many, many years for these parameters. So if we fetch the screen and we look at the results, the first thing that we could do is to be sure that the table is organized from high market cap to low market cap. And we can see here that there are a few companies. So, for example, we would see Apple, Microsoft, Google, Nvidia, Meta, etc. While for Nvidia, the total enterprise value of EBIT is 96, then we can see at the other extreme, the total enterprise value of EBIT of LVMH that is equal to 15, 16. This huge difference comes from, on the one hand, the market, because of course the price of these stocks can be in a bubble or not, and the market moves the price all over the places. But on the other side is also due to EBIT and the computation of EBIT. So, for example, for a company that invests a lot, EBIT could be lower than what the profitability of the company actually is because of very high R&D expenses. While in the case of LVMH, they could have very high margins. And one could go into the details and see that some of their expenditures is actually not very high compared to their revenue and did not explode while the revenue increased over the years. So this is just a comment, because when the total enterprise value over EBIT is very high, that could mean that the stock is very expensive, or it could mean that the EBIT is low because of the R&D expenses. On the other hand, if the total enterprise value of EBIT is quite low, that is more informative, because it's essentially saying that the company is already very profitable according to this accounting metric, that is EBIT. So if we go down a little bit, we see that there are other companies, for example, Hermes, whose multiples are quite high, but also their return on invested capital, return on assets, and growth is quite high. So every time we see a multiple that is high, we can also play this game mentally and look at the multiple not today, but in a few years, if the revenue growth and cash from operations growth will continue to be the same as it has been in the last few years. So, for example, in the case of Hermes, we see a total enterprise value of EBIT that is 30x. But we also see that revenue grew at 13% in the last 7 years. Cash from operations grew at 20%. So there has to be some growth around 15, perhaps. And so we can discount this multiple in the next few years, assuming that they will continue to get 15%. And so, for example, this means that if we read the multiple in the future and we divide 30 by 1.15, it will become 26. So it's 26 basically in 1 year EBIT. If we continue to do the computation, it's 22 in 2 years EBIT, it's 19 in 3 years EBIT, and so on. So the multiple seems quite high today, but if the company continues to grow, then in 2 or 3 years, the multiple, according to the EBIT that the company will have in 2 or 3 years, is not so high anymore. So for example, if Hermes continues to grow at 15% per year, in 3 years, the multiple will be 20, with, of course, the total enterprise value of today. And then, of course, if we go up, we can change the conditions and we can be much more restrictive than this. We could, for example, select an ROIC threshold equal to, let's say, 35% and a return on asset threshold equal to 15%, and even be more restrictive in terms of EBIT margin. So let's suppose that we have a 30% threshold on the EBIT margin and revenue growing much faster than 2%, let's say 7% per year in the last 7 years. By fetching the screen again, we get a list of companies, and this is a list that is a subset of the list of companies that we got before. And of course, now these companies have performance from a fundamental viewpoint that is better than the average company that was listed before. And perhaps this could be a first approach to look at the best of the best and to analyze some of them. As a final comment, I would like to highlight one limitation of these screeners. The limitation is that some companies that are actually good are screened out, are filtered out by these screeners, because the screeners refer to these accounting metrics that may not reflect the actual profitability and quality of the company. So for example, we didn't see Amazon. This is because the ROIC of Amazon is low. But actually the ROIC is low because the EBIT of Amazon is artificially low because of accounting rules. And so we covered this subject a few months ago, and we have a video with a spreadsheet where we adjust the ROIC and we show that the actual profitability of Amazon is much, much, much higher than the profitability that it seems by just looking at the income statement without the adjustments.
Great. And this concludes the video. If you want to follow our journey in investing, you can consider subscribing to this channel and giving us a like. This really helps a lot. And we're going to see you very soon. Bye-bye.